It's good to be together, church family. If you are watching us on our live stream, glad you've joined us in that way. If you happen to be new today, maybe it's your first time. I know I met a few people even out in the atrium. I'm really glad you're here. My name is Todd, and it's a pleasure to have you here on this Sunday, this Palm Sunday. Well, I want to start by telling you something you should know about me. I have a problem. Actually, I have a lot of problems. But I have a problem, and my problem is this, that I actually very easily fall asleep during movies. Anybody else have this problem? I feel, thank you for owning it. Like, I feel old just even saying that, but I just do it. It happens all the time to me, and even if I'm not tired, like, my eyes just get heavy, and I just end up falling asleep. And I'm not just talking about, like, boring movies or, like, romantic comedies that drag on or, like, the Barbie movie, you know, or something like that. I'm talking about, like, I've fallen asleep during Saving Private Ryan. Like, the troops are storming the beaches of Normandy, and I'm sitting there, like, just falling asleep. And it is a real problem. Now, interesting thing is my wife can't stand that about me. Right, babe? Like, we will be watching a movie together, like maybe we go on a date and we want to share in that moment together of a really good movie, and she'll be like, "You fell asleep." And I fell asleep sometimes during the most pivotal parts of a movie. And if you miss the most pivotal parts of a movie, you end up missing the whole point of the movie, and I wake up during the credits and say, what happened? But listen, the reason I tell you that is because we're about to talk today about the most pivotal scene, one of the most pivotal scenes in the story of Jesus, and Jesus' best friends slept through it all. My hope today is as we unpack this scene that all of us would have eyes wide open. No sleeping today, right? No sleeping, because we don't want to make the same mistake to miss what God has for us in this pivotal scene. And it's found in Matthew 26, and if you have your Bibles, you can actually turn to Matthew 26. But I also want to tell you, usually what we do is everything that we teach in here parallels what we teach back in our kids' ministry, so that if you have kids, you and your family can even have some discussion over what's talked about each week. This week is a little bit different. Back in kids' ministry, they're doing a traditional Palm Sunday, which would be to talk about the triumphal entry with Jesus riding on the donkey, the palm branches. Actually, just so you know, they have a live donkey back there today. Some of you might have seen it, so that it comes to life for kids. So if you hear like a really loud hee-haw during the service, you know why. It's all in the name of Jesus. His name is Lancelot, I think, the donkey. So we're grateful for his presence. I digress. We are going to do something a little different today, and I think it's going to be something that's going to set us up really well for Holy Week. And that's that we're going to go to the pivotal scene. It's the last scene that takes place before Jesus is arrested, and then you know the story. He's beaten, tried, crucified on the cross, which is what we celebrate and talk about this week, this Easter week. But the last scene is found in the Garden of Gethsemane. So Matthew chapter 26, starting in verse 36, it'll be on the screen for you to follow along. Also, always want to let you know, we have Bibles under the seats if you care to follow along in a hard copy. And if you don't have a hard copy, we'd love to give you one of those Bibles. You can literally just take it with you. It's on page 923 if you're following along in one of those Bibles. But it's Matthew 26, starting in verse 36. I'm going to read the whole story and then give you my 3 points. Here's what happens. Then Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." And taking with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, that's James and John, he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, "My soul is very sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and watch with me." And getting a little farther, he fell on his face and prayed, saying, "My Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." And he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, "So could you not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit is indeed willing, but the flesh is weak. Again, for the second time, he went away and prayed, My Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done. And again, he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the third time, saying the same words again. Then he came to the disciples and said to them, Sleep and take your rest later. They were sleeping again. See, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go, be going. See, my betrayer is at hand. It's God's word. It's the most pivotal scene right before Jesus is arrested and crucified. And there are three things that I want us to see in this passage this morning about Jesus. And here they are. It's not just the death. It's not just obedience. And it's not just love. It's not just the death. It's not just obedience. And it's not just love. All right, let me tell you and show you what I mean as we unpack this. First of all, it's not just a death. Back to those first couple verses. Verse 36. Jesus went with them to a place called Gethsemane. That's a garden, by the way. It's an olive press. And he said to his disciples, Sit here while I go over there and pray. And taking with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, he began to be really sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, My soul is very sorrowful, even to death. Remain here and watch with me. The phrase that is really powerful that you've never heard from Jesus up until this point is he says, My soul is so sorrowful that I want to die. Like, I feel like dying. What's happening in this moment is there is such emotional anguish and agony that Jesus is experiencing to the point where he's like, I don't even know if I want to live anymore. We've never seen Jesus like this until this point. Now, in Matthew's gospel, it's a little bit different, but in Luke's gospel, that Luke adds one detail, and it's probably because Luke was a doctor. And the detail he added was that Jesus was in such agony in the garden that actually he began to sweat to the point that he was sweating droplets of blood. You may have heard this before. And sweating droplets of blood is actually a real, legitimate condition that you can have. It's very rare, but it is possible. It's called, I think, hematidrosis is what it's called. I probably butchered the name. But my point is this, the agony that Jesus was going through right there in the garden was so horrific that he began to sweat blood. So, here's a question. Why in the world so much agony for the first time in Jesus' life? Why do we see that he's in so much agony? Well, the easy answer is this. He was about to die. The next day he was going to die. And I get that. That would make any of us agonize. But the reason it's not that simple. The reason I say that is because Jesus knew he was going to die. He talked about it throughout his life. There were times where he told his disciples, I'm going to die, and then I'm going to rise again. The disciples still didn't get it. But he would talk about it. So Jesus knew the plan of God was for him to die. So the question is, why? Why in the world did he have such agony this night before he died? Tim Keller says something that I think is really interesting. He says, you know, there are Christian martyrs who have actually died for the cause of Christ that seem to have died with less agony than we see Jesus going through in this moment. And I thought that was an interesting point, but it was a good point because what you see in the garden is that what Jesus was about to do on the cross was not just a death. It was more than just a death. It wasn't just another guy who died for a really good cause. It was so much more than that. Let me show you what I mean. Verse 39. And going a little farther, he fell on his face and prayed, saying, My Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. So Jesus gets to this point of sorrow, to the point where he goes, Father, could this cup pass from me? So at that point, we have to find out, what is the cup? What is this cup all about? Is it one of those new Stanley cups, you know, that everybody's doing? What is the cup? And we have to figure this out. So the cup is a metaphor in the Old Testament for God's wrath or God's judgment on sin. And the reason it was a good metaphor is because there was a point in time where one of the ways criminals would be executed is through getting a cup of poison and having to drink it down to the point where they would be executed. So that's why this is a good metaphor. So for Jesus to die, what he was doing is he was literally taking the wrath of God that was supposed to be on you and me, because we've all fallen short of God's glory. We've all sinned. We all have deserved the wrath of God. And instead of pouring it out on us, he was about to pour it out on Jesus. And this is really powerful, because it's not just the wrath of God on your sin individually or my sin individually. This is the wrath of God on the sins of all mankind, past, present, and future. This was all the evil in the world, from the white lie to Adolf Hitler, and it was all mixed together into a lethal cocktail that Jesus was about to drink down to the dregs for you and me. This was not just a death. It was so much more than that. Now, the worst part of God's wrath is actually that it cuts us off from his presence. That's the worst part about it. By the way, the worst part about hell is not that it's hot. The worst part about hell is actually that God is not there, that he's absent. And a lot of us can't really wrap our minds around it, but if God is not there, that means it is sheer horror and darkness, because even the worst that it gets on this earth, God still has some presence here. Not so in hell. The worst part about God's wrath is being cut off from the presence of God. That's what makes this such a horrific death. So for Jesus to go to the cross, it wasn't just a death. It was him experiencing the sheer darkness and horror of being cut off from the presence of his Father that he had only ever perfectly known. And it was horrific for him. Now back to the garden for a moment. The question still remains, why did Jesus have so much agony in this moment? Why didn't he have it before? Why didn't he ever have it earlier on in his life? And I think Jonathan Edwards is a Puritan preacher back in the 1700s, and he has this sermon, this old sermon called Christ's Agony, and it was just about this passage. And you can Google it if you want and like read it or hear somebody read it. But in that sermon, Jonathan Edwards makes this really, I think, really poignant point. And what Jonathan Edwards says is what you're seeing in the Garden of Gethsemane, and the reason why Jesus experienced so much agony is because for the first time in his humanity, he got an actual glimpse, a full picture into the horror and the darkness of what the cross was going to mean for him. And it just about crushed him. Like, it was overwhelming to him, to the point where he goes, "Father, Father, if there's any other way," he was on his knees begging for another way in his humanity. That's what you see in the garden. That's why this is not just a death. It's the worst. It's the worst death anyone has ever experienced in their lives. In the garden, Jesus, what he did was stared hell in the face to the point where he was sweating droplets of blood. And in that moment, he decided the next day he was going to go through with it. Now listen, could you imagine if the night before he died, he experienced that kind of horror? What was it like the night he did die? I want us to just wrap our minds around this. And as Jesus is going through all of this, he's on the ground. He is in horrific emotional pain. And look at verse 40. And they came to the disciples and found them, and he came to the disciples and found them sleeping. They were conked out. They were missing the whole thing. And I think what I want to challenge us with today as we approach Holy Week is let us not fall asleep on all that the death of Jesus means for you and me. It's not just the death. But that leads me to my next point, is that it's not just obedience. It's not just obedience. Yesterday, we had the privilege of doing a memorial service for Becky Blair. It's good to see you guys here this morning, sitting right where she sat. And listen, Becky was a wonderful, wonderful lady. And there was so much to celebrate. We talked about this, but she was literally the brightest light, even in the darkest of days. And if you knew Becky, you knew that. If you didn't know her, I would only have to explain a few things about her, and then you'd be, oh, yeah, I know Becky, because of the joy. She'd be singing the loudest. She'd have her hands raised the highest. And if you really still don't know, she always, on Sundays in the fall, wore a Miles Garrett jersey to church, which I really loved. But anyway, one of the things that struck me about Becky's life is that she had two significant bouts of cancer. The first bout of cancer, she was diagnosed and faced a tremendous road ahead, like everybody does when they're diagnosed with cancer. And she didn't have, at that point, my guess is she didn't have any idea of what it was going to be like. She just knew she had to do whatever it took. She didn't know the toll it was going to take on her body. She didn't know how it would affect her, the side effects, the sickness from the treatment, and how it would hurt her body, the emotional pain that she'd experience, the kind of toll it would take on her family through the process. She really didn't know any of that. She had never gone through it before. The Lord had cured her that first time, and she went into remission. But then when it came back, can you imagine having to face it for the second time? Because now she knew. Now she knew exactly what this was going to be like. She knew the horror. She knew what the side effects. She knew there could be, you know, infections, that there could be, you know, things that would happen to her, that she'd be immunocompromised. She may not be able to go to church. All these things right at once she knew, because she'd already went through it. And yet, Becky looked at cancer in the face and knew she had to do that if there was any chance that she was going to be able to survive. She willingly did it. And I want you to know, this is a glimpse at what you actually see with Jesus here in the garden. That what you see is that Jesus got the picture of what he was going to have to go through in order to pay for the sins of the world. And it was horrific and overwhelming and too much. And yet, listen to this. He said, not my will, but yours be done. He did it anyway. That's the greatest obedience that anyone has ever had. Listen, look at verse 42. It says again, for the second time, he went away and prayed, my Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done. Your will be done. Now, commentators, if you study this passage, a lot of them will say this: the reason that Jesus was experiencing so much agony is because God wanted us to see that for the first time in his humanity, he understood the full picture of the horror of what he was going to experience. And he wanted us to see that Jesus, even knowing it full well, still went through with it. It's obedience like no one's ever been obedient. And that's what separates, by the way, what Jesus did from everybody else. Jesus had the greatest obedience because he knew what was about to happen and he did it anyway. Now, the Garden of Gethsemane is a scene that also reminds us of another garden. Back in the Garden of Eden, and many of you know the story, Adam and Eve made a decision in the Garden of Eden in a moment of weakness. And the decision they made is this: not your will, God, but mine be done. Not your will, but mine be done. Not your way, but my way. And ever since then, all of us are born into a sin nature, born into a life where we say the same thing: not your will, but mine be done. We're not doing it your way, we're doing it our way. And just like what happened with Adam and Eve, that means we are separated from the God who made us. We are cut off from his perfect presence in our life. And it is horrific. What I want you to see is I am so ecstatically grateful that there is another garden. Because in the Garden of Gethsemane, something very different happened. Jesus stepped into that garden to say what you and I could never, ever say fully, and that is this: not my will, but yours be done. And with his simple act, amazing act of obedience, he paid for all of our disobedience. It's amazing. The first garden, we said, not your will, but mine be done. Second garden, Jesus says, not my will, but yours be done. And that obedience changed everything for you and me. Romans 5:19 actually says this very clearly. For as by the one man's disobedience, many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience, Jesus, the many will be made righteous. It's not just obedience. This is the greatest obedience that you've ever seen. And of course, Jesus, struggling with all this agony, finishes praying again. And look at verse 43. And again he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. And I think this is ironic. This tells you something about Jesus' obedience. Because what you see in this passage is that Jesus wanted nothing more than for his friends to be there for him in his darkest moment, but they weren't. They fell completely asleep. But here's what that tells you about Jesus' obedience. Even if you fall asleep, even if you completely ignore him, he still was obedient to the point of death. He still paid for the sins of the world. Whether you trust it or not, whether you accept it into your life and believe it's true, he still did it anyway, not even thinking that he would get anything in return. And that is the greatest obedience that none of us have ever experienced or done in our life. It's the power of what Jesus did for us. Now that leads me to the last point, which is that it's not just love. It's not just love. Let me review real quickly. It's not just death. It's not just the death. It's the most horrific death anybody's ever died. It's not just obedience. It is the greatest act of obedience that anyone has ever accomplished. And if those two things are true, then absolutely we have to say it's not just love. It is the greatest love that you and I could ever know. It is a love that has the power to literally transform your soul from the inside out. Now, one of the ways we know that it's that kind of love is because love takes sacrifice. You always sacrifice the most for the ones you love the most, right? So if you're married or if you have kids, you will do anything for them, because you love them. I've been married for 17 years, and my wife, Jillian, about 18 years ago, I emptied my bank account in order to give her an engagement ring. And I didn't even think twice about it, because I was in love. When we were dating, we were 4.5 hours away from each other, and we would literally, either of us would gladly drive the 9-hour round trip in a day just to see each other. We do crazy things for love, right? We make sacrifices the more that we love that person. And now we've been married for 17 years. Some of you know this, Jillian doesn't eat red meat. So I've been eating turkey bacon for 17 years. That's love. Listen, we always sacrifice for the people that we love the most. And I was thinking about this. You don't love my wife like I love my wife, so you would never sacrifice the real bacon for her, right? Only I would do that because I love her. And I want you to know that the greater the love, the greater the sacrifice, what does that tell you about how much Jesus loves you? It is immeasurable because we see the sacrifice. Now, there's a lot of people who take a look at God and say, I don't think God is a God of love, not the God of the Bible, because I see that he's also a God of wrath. And how could God love you if he sends people to hell? And I want you to know, I get that question. That's a hard question. That's a hard one. And if you wrestle with it, that's okay. You can wrestle with it. It's a challenging question. But I want you to know that this is how God can be a God of love. Because instead of putting the wrath that we deserved onto us, what we see in the garden is that he was going to pour the wrath out from our sin onto Jesus so that we could be free. We could be forgiven for all of eternity. When you take away the wrath of God, you make God less loving, not more loving. Do you see what we've been rescued from? Because on the cross and in the garden, what you see, first of all, is you have to see what we deserved because of our sin. You have to see that. You have to own that. But then you see that Jesus took it for you to forgive you and to free you forever. That is love like no one's ever loved you. But that's not just love. It's the greatest love that you've ever known. Another passage I want to read to you is Romans 5, 7, and 8. It says this, for one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would even dare to die. But God shows his love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. While we were still sinners, while we were ignoring him, while we were falling asleep, he died for us. And look, this story goes on. It's really interesting. Verse 44, for the third time, Jesus leaving them again, he went away and prayed for the third time, saying the same words. Then he came to the disciples and said to them, sleep and take your rest. Later on, they had fallen asleep again. See, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. What I love about this is that while his disciples are sleeping, all he wanted is these disciples to just be there with him, just stay awake for a little bit longer, and they couldn't. And yet, he looked at them and said, this world really needs me. They really need my sacrifice. And he willingly went to the cross. There's no love like that. Now listen, I think that there are people who would say to me, yeah, I get it that that's amazing love, but God could never love me. You don't know what I've done. And I've heard this. And I also know that there's people that have done a lot of really horrible things. By the way, I'm a pastor. This church is not filled with like all shiny, perfect people. We're filled with people who have done a lot of horrible things. That's why we're here. That's why we're here, right? Because we know that we can't save ourselves. But if you feel like you have massively failed, like even this week, if you feel like you could not be loved by God, then I want you to know something about the garden. Look at the garden. Jesus stared hell straight in the eyes, and it didn't stop him from going through with it. How could your sin, no matter how massive it is, break Jesus' love for you if he did that for you? Right? His love is unrelenting. And I want you to know, it doesn't matter what you've done. He paid for it. It's just a matter if you're going to take it or not, if you're going to believe it. Now, I want to close us by saying it's Holy Week. And the reason we're doing this message is because I want us to go into Holy Week in a reflective nature about all that this means for us. So I hope this does set us up for that. But I also want you to just be challenged. Don't fall asleep on all that the death of Jesus means for you and me. It's more than a death, it's more than obedience, and it's more than love. It's the greatest love that you could ever know. And so I want to close out our time today in a little bit of a different way than we typically do. Instead of singing a song, standing up in worship, we're just going to spend some time in reflection. And I want to be quiet before the Lord and give you time to digest. The Holy Spirit works when God's word is presented. And so I believe fully right now that the Holy Spirit is working, and it's not in a weird way, it's in a very powerful way. And the Holy Spirit is saying something to some of you. And I don't know what that is, but I want to give you time to reflect. And there's a few things that you could reflect upon. The first thing is that you might be coming off a week where you have massively failed, where you feel like you can't be loved, where you can't be forgiven. And I want you to look at the garden and look at Jesus, how he looked hell square in the eyes. And it didn't break his stride. He just kept going because he loved you that much. And if hell couldn't break him, then your sin can't. Would you just confess it to him this morning and leave it behind because he paid for it once for all on the cross, and he's not going to do it again because the Bible says it worked the first time. It's just a matter of if you believe that. And then the second thing is, like, maybe today you're just something clicked that you realize something about Jesus that maybe you never have. Maybe you realize just how much he loves you. Would you just spend some time just thanking him? Just saying, man, I can't believe what you've done for me. And maybe you even open your hands and go, my life is yours. Like, I don't know how anyone would do that for me, but because you have, I'll do anything for you. And maybe God's calling you to do something today as a result. And then the last thing is this, that maybe somebody in here has never actually taken that step across the line of faith for the first time to say, hey, I've never thought that what he did was actually personal for me. And so today is the day you say, Jesus is my Lord and my Savior. He died for me, and I place my faith in him. You could say those simple words. I believe you died for me, and I place my faith in you. Whatever it is that God is doing in our midst, take a minute, reflect upon it, and leave here with the next step. And then Brandon will come up and close in prayer.
As we head into Holy Week and reflect upon the service that we just had and the sermon that you just heard, it may be that message of God shows his love for us and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. It may be that for the first time you realize that you're a part of that and that you trust that what Jesus has done. I mean, the story from here goes that Jesus is he's arrested, he's put on trial, and then he does go through with it, and he does go to the cross and bleeds and dies and suffers in our place. And so for the first time, you might be like, that's something I believe. So I'm going to have the prayer team come forward now, and that's one thing that you could pray with the prayer team. And it might be that this morning is the day of turning to Jesus for the first time, and we want to be a part of that journey with you. But also here at Silver Creek, we believe that for everybody, whether you are coming to faith for the first time or whether you've been a believer for 40 years, there's a next step for you as a result of every Sunday, as a result of every week. And you might not even know exactly what that next step is. It just might be something going on in your life that you need prayer for, and that's what the prayer team's here for. But we've also made a way, if you want to text us later and let us know, hey, I want to take a next step, I need a prayer request, or I'm just new here and I just want to get plugged in, then there's a number behind me and there's the words next steps that you can text, and we want to connect with you and we want to help you with that. So as we close our service, would you please bow for the benediction? May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you his peace today and forever. Amen.